might have your attention, please. On behalf of radio station KJOY, I'd like to welcome you, our studio audience, to this evening's preview of the big Christmas broadcast of 1941. In just 10 short minutes, we will be going live into the homes of thousands out there in Radioland to remind them that Christmas is just 23 days away. You'll be thrilled with our great lineup of studio guests this evening. And now we have just a few more technical details to attend to up here on the studio platform, and then I'll be back with you to prepare you, our studio audience, for this evening's broadcast. Once again, I welcome you to KJOY. In just a few minutes, we will start that preview of the big Christmas broadcast 1941. So there are just a few details that you need to be aware of as a studio audience. First, you'll be a big help to our studio musicians by responding to the applause sign. In fact, I'd like to try that right now. Not bad for your first try. Let's practice it one more time, though. Good. I think you've got it. Secondly, we ask that you remember that when the white light is on, we are on the air, and we ask that you be quiet and remain in the studio. And now, I'd like to introduce you to our studio band, the Rocky Mountaineers. Ron, let's get one more sound check on the band, and then we'll be ready for this evening's broadcast. Thank you.
Jerry Brainerd coming to you live on December 2nd, 1941. The Continental Broadcasting Company is pleased to bring you an early sampling of the music and magic of the Christmas season. We're broadcasting live from magnificent Mile High, Denver, Colorado tonight, bringing you a special holiday treat featuring so many of the musical stars you'll be enjoying on Christmas Eve, when this station broadcasts the most eagerly awaited event of the year, the big Christmas broadcast of 1941. In just a moment, you'll be hearing special sounds of the season by our very own studio singers, the Seasonaires. Yes. And as special guests, right here with our studio audience, the Norman Luboff Chorale. But first, a word from our sponsor. Say, for all you turkey addicts out there who are just about to bite into that leftover turkey leg right now, a timely message from Bromo Seltzer.
Man sakes, that's the trouble with that new technology. You let it into your home and then it tries to run your life. Of course, this is the only time of day I get a chance to listen to the radio. What with everybody fighting over the Green Hornet or Jack Benny. Then that news from overseas breaking in about every 5 minutes. You see, the rest of the family's downstairs playing Parcheesi. Boy, I hope that game lasts long enough for me to get a chance to listen to this next broadcast. It's a preview of the big Christmas broadcast of 1941.
Remember, it's all only 22 days away.
I've been waiting for this all year long.
Welcome to the season when dreams come true.
Cheers! earlier every year. Who was at the door a little bit ago?
Christmas presents from some of Grandpa's admirers, Mom. Mrs. Yannitelli with her eggnog, and Mrs. Hubbard with her fruitcake. Yuck! I still have some of that stuck in my teeth from last Christmas.
Now, Mickey, it was a nice gesture. Angie, come help me with the eggnog and fruitcake.
Oh, it's beyond help.
Turn down that radio. Dad, where'd you put the eggnog and fruitcake?
Oh, down?
What? Sis, wasn't there a leftover turkey leg?
What?
Right here from this very station, the Continental Broadcasting Company will be bringing you the big Christmas broadcast of 1941.
Oh, man,
and now the normal LaBelle Corral with the season air.
Under your tree, it's Christmas time.
It's Olivia Oranges. You know, they're a great source of the vitamin C you need for your color, your character, and your colon. Why don't you pick up a bunch today? And now stay tuned for the further adventures of that masked rider of the plains, the Lone Ranger.
Did I say something? Oh, the kitchen.
Make a note of that, Angie.
Goodbye, Mr. West. Bye, Angie.
See you tomorrow, Danny. About 5.
Oh, there's still 5 minutes of the Frankie Donatello show left.
And what do you want for Christmas, Angie?
I don't know, Pops. I hadn't really thought about it.
Just kind of slipped your mind, huh?
Each day I sit at home, waiting by my telephone, knowing I will be alone once more, wishing you could be sitting here with me, but it's just a fantasy for without Christmas is blue. Snowmen melt in the sun, and Christmas cards come with postage due. Without just won't shine, and my needles are dry, and reindeer can't fly, and church bells won't chime if you're not mine. But if you were here, I'd hold you so near, there'd be holiday cheer and a happy new year. But you're not, so I'm caught in this spot so distraught. Ah! Oh, what can I do without you? Bid romance adieu, and my fire won't burn, and so I just turn and close up the flue. My tinsel has all been tangled, my jingle bells have been jangled, my choir leader I strangled.
Few songs I know. I just don't have much of a chance to sing them lately. Besides, love's about a lot more than Junes and Moons.
Oh, I know that, but that always seems to be the best part.
No, Angie. The part of love that's best is the part that lasts through the Moons and Junes, through all those tough times. And that's the love worth hanging on to. Come on, dinner's ready.
I guess both my girls want the same thing for Christmas.
You do? I didn't know you wanted a rhinestone, Snoop.
Oh, yes.
Trust me, they want the same thing. I guess we all do. Just for there to be peace on earth again, and to be with the ones that we love. It's funny how prayers and dreams at Christmas time are often one and the same.
Dad, dinner.
Oh, I'm coming. I'm going to turn the radio back up while we eat. There's only 21 more days left. I can't wait to hear who's on tonight.
And now some more appetizers of what's to come on the big Christmas broadcast. Let's start out tonight with the beguiling Quackenbush Sisters singing a new holiday hit, I'm Wishing You a Merry, Merry Christmas.
Wishing you a merry, merry Christmas and a happy, happy, happy new year. Time for feeling jing-jing-a-lee, jingle-bell, jingle-lee. Kris Kringle-ee, I'm wishing you a merry, merry Christmas and a happy, happy year the year through. This very day I'll pack away and send it by sleigh. Christmas wish to you.
shadow.
Who knows what evil lurks in the hearts of men? The shadow knows.
What is it? Norma, I was about ready to kiss an angel. You about gave me a heart attack.
Oh. I'm sorry, Dad. Still working on that turkey leg, huh?
I think we can pronounce last rites on that. What are you doing down here all by yourself?
Praying.
Oh, yeah, right, with the shadow.
Oh, all right. The shadow is Pete's favorite radio show. He never misses an episode. I just want to keep up on all the stories so I can tell him when he comes home.
You're not afraid he's not coming home, are you?
Oh, Pop, I can't even begin to figure this world out anymore. It's turned so upside down.
Yeah, you're right. We're just mighty lucky that the Lord's in the middle of all of it to help us keep our balance.
Is the Lord in the middle of this? I just don't see where. Besides, nothing's turning out the way I thought it would.
No, we don't always have a lot to say about how things turn out. That's somebody else's job.
Mama's Bible.
Shine that light over here, will you? I can hardly see these words.
So old and faded you can hardly read it anymore.
You know, this Bible saw more action in the last war than the Battle of Verdun. I guess I should get a new one. Oh, well. I know this by heart. Your mom used to quote it to me so often. For I consider that the sufferings of this present world are not to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed to us.
I really miss Mom sometimes.
I miss her too. All the time.
Pop, what could possibly be worse than celebrating Christmas alone?
I don't know, but when you find out, will you let me know? This is the 24th Christmas that I've been alone, without the woman that I plan to spend every Christmas with. Just when I think I've put it behind me, I see something. You know, the azaleas underneath the kitchen window? That pair of slippers that the dog had chewed? The white handkerchief that she used to use as a bookmark? And it all comes rushing back, the sounds and the feelings. Remember how we used to snuggle on the couch on Christmas Eve? And then she'd start singing in that slightly off-key voice of hers? She left us too soon. It hasn't been easy, but it's gotten better. You know, I'm a tough pupil, but the Lord's been able to teach me a thing or two over the years. At Christmas time, when someone leaves this world, it's important for us to remember that at Christmas time, we celebrate someone coming into this world. Without him, I don't think I would have made it. I'm going back to bed. Are you coming?
No, I think I'll stay down here by myself for a while. No, not by myself.
No, not by yourself. Good night, sweetheart.
Good night, Dad.
And now the season airs with a brand new Christmas favorite.
Christmas, you.
Wake up, America! It's 9 a.m. on Thursday, December 4th, and the makers of Gillette Shaving Cream are bringing you the Buddy Burfine Sports Heroes Scrapbook. Today we bring you the story of quarterback Buck Shriver, but first, a word from our sponsor.
Buck? My kidney plaster? He's nothing compared to Howard the Slingshot West, third-string quarterback of USC's almost championship team of 1903.
And now the sports legend of Buck Shriver.
This is my favorite show.
Who was a kid from Kentucky, who was a young boy.
I don't know who that is, but I hope they don't stay long. I've been waiting for this show all night long. Danny, why am I not surprised to see you again?
Was that the doorbell I heard? Is it a telegram?
No, I have a delivery for Angie.
Who shall I call to come get their package?
No, this is for Angie.
Well, I'll be. It is for Angie.
I know that for a fact, because, well, I sent it. I figured it was time I spoke up, told her how I felt, so I mailed her something.
I think she'll get the message.
We interrupt this program for an important news bulletin. The AP wire services have just reported that the German offensive in Russia has been defeated.
Oh, yes.
Hitler's armies have suffered heavy losses and have been driven out of Moscow by Marshal Zhukov.
Yes.
We will keep you advised on further developments in this case. We now return you to our regular programming.
Oh, praise God, Pete will be coming home.
You know, but that's only one battle.
Oh, but the war's gonna be over.
I pray you're right, Princess. Oh, I really do.
This is wonderful.
Remember, it's all only 20 more days until the big Christmas broadcast.
Hope is just around the corner. Joy is knocking at the door. Wrap up your dreams in crimson and green and deck the beams. Down to the floor and stuff some faith in.
radio in the last 36 hours. We stayed right beside it yesterday, even into the night. We all stayed. Every now and then, one of us would sleep, and then we'd wake back up and listen some more. We talked. We prayed. We sang. It was like we'd never felt so alone. We just wanted to be together.
Our latest bulletin puts the casualties at Pearl Harbor at over 2,600 dead servicemen and 60 civilians. We have received reports that the Japanese have attacked Hong Kong, the Philippines, Guam, and Wake Island. We are all asked to keep our lights off again tonight. Meantime, in Europe, German armies continue to occupy additional sections of southern France.
That's enough of that. I think sometimes we spend too much time listening to the world and not enough time listening to God. Mickey, I don't know. Are you scared?
No. Yeah.
Yeah, me too.
I don't even know who the bad guys are anymore. Who are we fighting, Grandpa?
We're fighting the bad side of people. All people. It's called sin. But you know what? That battle's been won. Jesus did it for us. He did it for all of us.
No, stay put. I'll get it.
What time is it? I haven't looked at a watch in hours.
It's about 7 o'clock at night.
Danny, what are you doing here?
Little late for a delivery, isn't it?
I have a telegram. It's from the Word of Harper.
Pete's all right!
Oh, yes.
But his squadron's shipping out tomorrow, and I don't know where he's going, or when I'll hear from him, or when I'll ever get to see him again.
I've joined too. I won't leave for a couple of days yet, and I'm not sure where I'm going, but I know it's what I'm supposed to do.
How do you know? How does anyone know what the right thing to do is anymore?
Well, didn't you get my package?
What package?
Oh, sweetheart, I'm sorry. Danny brought that on Wednesday.
A new Bible.
Angie's always told me what a strong woman your mother was. And how she taught you girls of God's working through all things. I know how much her Bible means to you all, but I understand the words have gotten awfully faded and hard to read. And I just felt this would be a time where it'd be important to have those words clear and easy to see. Angie, I'll come to see you before I leave.
We'll be praying for you, son.
Thank you, Mr. West. Goodbye, Angie.
What's happening to this world? Why is God letting this happen?
Sweetheart, God doesn't give us easy answers about war and death. What he did give us was himself.
I know, Pops. It's just so hard to watch your dreams die.
I know. But God's always working on dreams. It's just that sometimes they're his. Bethlehem was a lot like our world tonight. Dark and empty, filled with armies and dictators and frightening futures. But those people had dreams too. Dreams of being free. Dreams of seeing their world made right again. They've been waiting a long time. Some of them have been waiting almost 2,000 years. But God answered their dreams in a way they didn't expect. Not with armies or dictators. But with a baby. When those wise men and shepherds looked at that Christ child, they didn't understand everything at night, but they did have enough faith to know that God's plan was bigger than theirs.
I guess you can say that sometimes your dreams don't come true, so God can make a bigger dream, his dream, come true for everyone.
And sometimes it takes a while to see that.
Oh, and sometimes it takes a while.
Listen, They're broadcasting again.
Ladies and gentlemen, an excerpt of President Roosevelt's address to Congress from earlier today.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. The attack yesterday on the Hawaiian Islands has caused severe damage to American naval and military forces. I regret to tell you that very many American lives have been lost. In addition, American ships have been reported torpedoed on the high seas between San Francisco and Honolulu. I believe that I interpret the will of the Congress and of the people when I assert that we will not only defend ourselves to the uttermost, but will make it very certain that this form of treachery shall never again endanger us. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God.
Looks like we won't be having the big Christmas broadcast this year, huh, Grandpa?
Looks like it, Mick. I guess that's just one more thing for us to add to our list and wait for God's timing on.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Continental Broadcasting Company wishes to announce that due to the current national emergency, the big Christmas broadcast will not be aired on Christmas Eve.
You're right, Mick.
Instead, it'll be broadcast tonight. That's right. Every star scheduled to appear is here in our studio tonight. Some had to travel halfway across the country, but they're all here tonight with only one thought, and that's to help bring Christmas into your homes tonight and to pray that peace will come to our world once again.
Locked outside the door.
Whatever our fate, together we'll take. Whatever daybreak may have in store for faith and facing to tomorrow.
Season air singing, I heard. heard the bells on Christmas Day.
Let me assure you that we've saved the best for last. We're so grateful that you've come. We want to be of help to you in any way that we can. When you came in this evening, you saw some brochures at your seats, and inside that brochure is a card. And if you'd like to complete that card and give that to one of our members or one of the ushers, or you just leave it there as you leave this evening, that'd be fine. We'd be happy to respond to any questions or concerns that you might raise. If you'd like to give that card to one of our members, you may need a little bit of help in identifying who these fine folks are. See, we have a bit of a problem. We only have a thousand or so of us who are members of this church, but we have some 7,000 coming to Rocky Mountain Christmas this year. Those of you who are guests, wouldn't you like to see some of the members of this church? Well, I'm not just the senior pastor of this church. I actually consider myself to be the senior pastor. And I'm going to ask all of the members and all the regular attenders, would you stand up, please, right now? Would you stand to your feet and remain standing? Okay. Now, I don't want to give you guys who are guests any ideas, but just take a look here. You guys could take over this church tonight if you want it. Okay. All right, now here's what you can do. We're going to have a brief intermission, just 3 minutes or so, and during this time, you are welcome to greet any of our members, okay? And as you do so, you are more than welcome to tell them what you want for Christmas this year, and they're very generous people. Or you can ask them any embarrassing question that you'd like to ask. And we've had some great illustrations of that already. So would you all join us? Let's stand together and have some fun, okay? Greet some folks and mingle and share some joy. 3 minutes to do that.
Missing loved ones. But we learned something that Christmas, something that I'll always treasure, that the real meaning of Christmas is hope for the world and hope for all of us. Oh, but I'm getting ahead of myself here. The Christmas tree has always been a central part of our family festivities. So tonight, gather with us as family and friends around our Christmas tree. Join us for a few minutes of Christmas joy as our tree comes alive with worship and praise.
Christmas song of the angels. Thank you.
can sing. A thrill of hope, a weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. This is the season of hope and good cheer. Well, that's what the radio advertisements tell us anyway. But hope for what? Well, I hope I get a new tie for Christmas. I hope that Pete comes home soon. I hope that this pain in my chest isn't serious. When we didn't have hope, when we should have been abandoned to a life of emptiness and fear and pain, God gave us hope. Hope in the form of a baby. And that baby, well, he grew to be a man. And that man, Jesus, is our certain hope. But hope for what? Well, how about hope for a life filled with purpose? How about hope for a world filled with love? At Christmas time, we celebrate the fact that God made room for each of us in his world and in his heaven. Oh, I know sometimes life seems so useless and so hopeless for all of us. But on that very first Christmas, God reached out his hand to every one of us and he said, "You don't have to live with that anymore. I've made a way for you. We're going to get through this thing together."
Judges.
In 1 and 2 Samuel, he is our trusted prophet. And in Kings and in Chronicles, he is our reigning king. In Ezra, he is our faithful scribe. In Nehemiah, he is the rebuilder of everything that is broken. And in Esther, he is the Mordecai sitting faithfully at the gate. In Job, he is my redeemer that ever liveth. In Psalms, he is my shepherd and I shall not want. In Proverbs and Ecclesiastes, he is our wisdom. And in the Song of Solomon, he is the beautiful bridegroom. In Isaiah, he is the suffering servant. In Jeremiah and Lamentations, it is Jesus that is the weeping prophet. In Ezekiel, he's the wonderful four-faced man. And in Daniel, he is the fourth man in the midst of the fiery furnace. In Hosea, he is my love that is forever faithful. In Joel, he baptizes us with the Holy Spirit. In Amos, he is our burden bearer. In Obadiah, our Savior. And in Jonah, he is the great foreign missionary who takes the word of God into all the world. And we go on and we see that in Micah, he is the messenger with beautiful feet. In Nahum, he is the avenger. In Habakkuk, he is the watchman ever praying for a revival. In Zephaniah, he is the Lord mighty to save. In Haggai, he is the restorer of our lost heritage. In Zechariah, he is our fountain. And in Malachi, he is the son of righteousness with healing in his wings. In Matthew, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. In Mark, he is the miracle worker. In Luke, he is the Son of Man. And in John, he is the door by which every one of us must enter. In Acts, he is the shining light that appears to Saul on the road to Damascus. In Romans, he is our justifier. In 1 Corinthians, our resurrection. In 2 Corinthians, our redeemer. In Galatians, he redeems us from the law. In Ephesians, he is our unsearchable riches. In Philippians, he supplies our every need. And in Colossians, he is the fullness of the Godhead bodily. In 1 and 2 Thessalonians, he is the soon coming King. In 1 and 2 Timothy, he is a mediator between God and man. In Titus, he is our blessed hope. In Philemon, he is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. In Hebrews, he is the blood of the everlasting covenant. And in James, it is the Lord that heals the sick. In 1 and 2 Peter, he is the chief shepherd. In 1 and 2 and 3 John, it is the Lord that has the tenderness of love. In Jude,
Kings and the Lord of Lords, the creator of life, the victor over death, and the giver of hope. Hope. It's what all of us need. But some here tonight may be hurting so badly that you think you're beyond hope. Well, nothing could be further from the truth. For no one knows enough to be a pessimist. God has control. He will prevail. The one who knows you the best loves you the most. And there are no secrets with him. He knows everything. He knows your circumstances, and he knows mine. He knows your fear, and he knows mine. He knows your selfishness, and he knows mine. He knows your guilt, and he knows mine. He knows your problems, and he knows mine. He knows your weaknesses, and he knows mine. But this great God doesn't just understand our situation, our pressures. This great God also understands our potential. He understands our future, and he knows what it can be as we put our full trust in him. In fact, just as a good author saves the best part for the last part, and just as a great conductor keeps the finest for the finish, so it is with God. The great God of the universe, the author of hope, with him, through his Son Jesus Christ, the best is yet to be. We believe that. All of the actors you've heard tonight, and the orchestra members, and all of this choir, not just fine performers, great entertainers, but fervent believers, and we love to be of help to you. We hope you're glad you came tonight. It's been a privilege to have you here, and we look forward to having you come again. Are you glad you're here? So many things to say in so little time. I want to give some special recognition very briefly. First to the director of drama for this tremendous effort from David Wall. I don't know where David is right now. I want to thank David. And to this tremendous orchestra. They're really fabulous. And the one who helped to bring this all together, our intern for Rocky Mountain Christmas this year, Ron Ballard. Ron, would you stand first? Thank you. And now the orchestra, would you stand, please? We're really grateful to you. Last count, I think we have some 77 in our choir, and the one who's drawn all of this together, we want to recognize him. He's the magnificent maestro, Paul Stettler. Would you stand, please? We hope that we'll be seeing you again. There's a lot more in store for you than some of you can even imagine. We'd love to have you return to Rocky Mountain Christian Church. In fact, if you don't have a church home, we'd like for you to consider this to be your church home. Now, I realize that some are here this evening from other churches. That's okay. We consider you spies, though. We're very happy to have you, though. We have many others, though, that are not connected with a caring Christian community. And our ministry is reaching out to Boulder County and beyond, and we're very happy to have you with us this evening. And if you don't have a place to worship tomorrow, at 9 o'clock and at 10:30, we'd like to welcome you here, identical services and programs for your children as well. And our theme tomorrow is Angels All Around. Maybe you've heard that angels are hot right now, and we're going to be talking about that tomorrow. We'd love to have you return. We're going to pray and close things out, but what you are going to hear following the prayer is going to be a great source of inspiration to you. It's one of my favorite songs, and it really is a grand finale for this wonderful evening. Let's pray and give God the praise. Father, we do thank you for the privilege of being here tonight. We thank you for the inspiration of this night, for the joy of this night. We give you the credit and the honor. Now may the God of hope fill you with joy and peace as you trust in him. May you overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we would ever ask or even imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus and throughout this Christmas and for every Christmas to come, forever and ever. Amen.
Was born on Christmas. thanks again for